Good afternoon, everyone. This is Brother Lloyd. And to those who are keeping the Sabbath today, Shabbat Shalom. I hope you're having a blessed and a peaceful Sabbath. Now, we're going to dive right into this subject because it is confusing enough as is. We're going to talk about death. And my objective in teaching the Father's Word here is to try and give someone some clarity and understanding what the Word says about death, as opposed to all these different things that have been taught and all these different understandings that people have. So I'm going to try and give a concise and clear, simple understanding of what the Father's Word says. And it's up to you all to study it and let the wisdom and knowledge of the Father percolate that in your brains and help you with the discernment that you will need to understand death, because it's going to happen to most of us, and very few to none of us will avoid it in some form or another, family members, friends, whatever. And with that being said, the first question is, if someone came up to you and said that your mother, your brother, your sister, father, mother, whoever were going to die, would you get upset? And most people probably would. For me, not so much. I would be curious as to, well, why would you ask me that? But I'm already aware of it, so it's really not a offensive question or anything like that, but most people would be offended. But go with me to Ecclesiastes 9:5. Now, I don't have to open scripture on this one because it's on my personalized license plates on my car, because that's a little subtle way that I can get the message out there. Some people ask, well, what scripture is that? And some people, I'm sure, if they can't ask me, they may open their Bible when they get home and say, I wonder what that scripture was. And that's some way to get people interested in the notion of death, because scripture speaks about it in no uncertain terms in many places, and we all need to understand it. So, Ecclesiastes 9:5 reads, it says, for the living know that they shall die, but the dead know not anything, neither have they any more reward, for the memory of them is forgotten. But we're going to add verse 6 to that because it's just as pertinent. It says, also their love and their hatred and their envy is now perished, neither have they any more a portion forever in anything that is done under the sun. How much clearer can the Father's Word be in saying that our dead loved ones, even those we don't know, those who disliked us, dead in general have nothing to do with anything. They have no awareness. They are dead and gone. The Word is very clear. It says they have no participation in anything left on this planet. So we ask the question, well, why are all these other different things taught? Because people misunderstand scripture by looking at other scriptures and then misinterpreting those instead of just reading scripture for what it says. I just read scripture for what it says. And if I believe what the Father's Word says in Ecclesiastes 9:5-6, I'm halfway there, because it's very simple and clear. No need to complicate the Father's Word. Now, when we have questions about other scripture that seem to maybe contradict that or whatever, then we need to dig and search so we can go, oh, okay, I get it. In fact, some of us will not see death at the second advent of our Savior. Now, you may ask a question, well, Ecclesiastes 9:5 says that for the living know that they shall die. And now I'm telling you that some of us won't see death at the second advent, because when he comes to get his righteous, 1 Thessalonians 4:16 says that what? The dead in Christ shall rise first. And then those who are alive, see, those who are alive, they haven't seen death. So how are they not going to see death but be called up? Glad you asked. Simple answer is, if they haven't seen the physical death, but yet they're righteous, they have died to sin. And see, this is what we need to do. We need to not focus so much on the physical death. We need to focus on our spiritual death. We need to die to sin. See, this physical body can be resurrected or what have you. But if we die spiritually unrighteous, we're going to die permanently physically unrighteous. Because once we die physically, we cannot change our state that we die in. So we're going to die as we are. Now, the Father's word, like I said, is simple and clear, but man complicates it for various reasons, some intentionally to mislead and misdirect people, and other out of ignorance and misunderstanding. They teach misguiding and deceptive things to people and aren't even aware that they're doing it because they don't understand what they're teaching. But let's go back over Ecclesiastes 9, 5, and 6, and it says a few things, and I'm just going to point out four. One, it says that we know that we're going to die. All of us living know that we're going to die. Two, the dead know nothing. Now, many people want you to think that your dead loved ones are off in some type of form or another doing all sorts of things, but we're going to address that because that is not true. Remember, for everything that the Father has, says, and does, the enemy has a counterfeit. The enemy has a big part in death, especially in the deception. It contradicts everything that the Father tells us in His Word. Number three, it says that they have no more reward in anything, and that includes anything under the sun, no participation whatsoever. And it also says that even their memory is forgotten. So people, the Father's Word is so clear about deceased people. Embrace it. Don't overanalyze it. It is very simple and clear. Don't let the things opposite to what these two scriptures say cause you to doubt the Father's word. Anything contrary to this is gotta be work of the enemy. Let's move on to Job 14:21. Now, this is given as an example about our dead loved ones and their memory. Now, and it reads in part, it says, his sons come to honor him, and he knoweth it not, and they are brought low, but he perceive it not of them. Now, this is an example of how we do as people. We go to the cemetery to talk to our dead loved ones, and we kneel down, or we lay down, or we sit by their graveside, and we talk to them and all these things. But the word says that they perceive it not of us. They have no awareness. See, once again, the Father's word is clear. We are doing this of our own accord, but dead people have no awareness, no participation, no memory, nothing. The Father is simple and clear for lots of reasons. We don't need the burden of trying to figure out what's going on with dead loved ones. That's why the Father's word is so clear about what happens to us all when we die. So, this is hard for some people to hear, but the Father wants us to have an understanding of death so we don't, suffer unnecessarily and grieve unnecessarily. Remember, the enemy is at work in all this also. Now, Job 7:9-10 read like this. It says, as the cloud is consumed and vanished away, so he that goeth down to the grave shall come up no more. He shall return no more to his house, neither shall his place know him any more. Look, I just read a few scriptures, and it's telling us everything to verify, to clarify, to nail down the fact that the Father says dead people are dead and they are done with. Until he does anything with anyone that has passed on, they have no involvement of anything. So before you allow your mind to run with all these things that apparently, allegedly, supposedly go on, whether it's being taught by a preacher, pastor, or whomever, or someone says they saw, or this and the other, understand, like I said, the enemy is at work. So, but we're going to get to that. Now, think about verse 10 that I just read in Job 7. Job 7, verse 10. And the people claim, like I said, to have seen dead loved ones after they have died. The Father, like I said, in no uncertain terms, says this thing is not happening. His word has just told us in various scriptures that I read you what happens. So, simply put, what we're dealing with here is the enemy. We are seeing our dead loved ones, whomever. They may not even be people you know, but if you see any type of figments, ghostly figures, or whatever, of dead loved ones, especially because those who come to people so you can recognize who they are, it'd be no point in just random demons coming to you in the form of people if you didn't know them. It may startle you or scare you or whatever, but most people claim to see dead parents, children, or whomever. This is the enemy. These are demons in the form of people. Now, you may say, well, why would they do this? They haven't harmed me. Some of them are nice. They give me information, this and the other. Deception. Three words. Deception. The enemy is a master at deception. If he can deceive you with his counterfeits, he can distract you from the truth. See, when we're distracted from the truth, it harms us spiritually, because if we stay distracted from the truth, we start going off into all sorts of other things. People who have been distracted from the truth with seeing spirits and ghosts and all these different things, they get caught up in soothsayers, witches, fortune tellers, all this type of stuff. And this all is in total contradiction to what the Father's Word teaches about evil. Remember, during this time of King Saul, he had them kill witches, warlocks, soothsayers, all these different communicators with the dead, because the Father says this is evil. So don't be deceived by the enemy with this type of stuff. There is a method to his madness to keep you from focusing on the Father and his word. Now go with me to Isaiah 26:14, which is cut and dry, and it reads like this. It says, they are dead, they shall not live, they are deceased, they shall not rise. Therefore thou hast thou visited and destroyed them and made all their memory to perish. People, scripture after scripture after scripture just keep nailing it home about what happens to any and everyone who is dead. The Father wants us to understand in no uncertain terms that dead people have no participation in anything going on in this planet once they go down to the grave. Why? Because it helps us. It helps us. It helps us to be able to understand that they're in a state that they can't be bothered, that they won't be bothered, that they're not suffering, that they're not doing anything. The Father says this in all his word. Also, it serves to keep us from being distracted by foolishness of the enemy. Like I said, when we start seeing all these different things that are contrary to all these scriptures that I've read so far, we immediately have to know, oh, that's the enemy, and you can't let him get you with that. You have to be able to recognize this so you can rebuke the madness. If you can't rebuke it and you buy into it, now you have a whole new set of problems going on in your life. So the Father, like I said, is clear about what happens to us when we die. So we have to really understand what this spirit thing is, or this apparition or ghost. See, people get all these different things confused and wad them up into being the same thing. And that's not true. These are all different things, but people use them interchangeably. So we have to ask the question as to why would our Father in heaven allow any loved one to go and immediately be with him? See, because some people teach this, but everything I read is in contrast to that. It's contrary to that. It's not true. But people are teaching that our dead loved ones go to be with the Father. They use the teaching of Abraham's bosom and all these other things to teach this kind of stuff. But it's not true unless you're going to contradict the Father's word. He wants us to not suffer. He wants us to be relieved about things. He wants us to focus on him. He wants us to get right while we're alive. Save our souls while we're alive. Go with me to Revelation 14:21 and verse 4. And it reads like this. It says, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. Now, if our dead loved ones died and went straight to heaven, why would they not come back to communicate with us, to teach us, to warn us, to be at our side and doing all these things to keep us from falling to sin? See, that's too much involvement. Things of heaven righteousness in heaven cannot be involved with sin. So if our loved ones died and we're sitting in heaven watching all this madness and chaos that we're enthralled in, it would grieve them, it would pain them, it would suffer them to sit and watch this and not be able to interact with us. This is why Revelations 21:4, which I just read, said there's no sorrow, there's no crying, there's none of all these emotional gamuts of feelings are not going on in heaven. Therefore, it would stand to reason that there's another reason why our loved ones can't be there now, because they would have to watch all this and it would make them feel a certain way. And that's not in the character or spirit of a righteous person. So they're not in heaven. Once again, something else to solidify that they are not there. Now, Ecclesiastes 12:7 reads like this. It says, "Then shall the dust return to the earth as it was, and the spirit shall return unto God who gave it."